Welcome to Cambridge House Live. I'm Bridget Anderson, and I am joined by Amir Adnani, the CEO of Uranium Energy Corp. Thanks for being with us today.
Yeah, great to be here, Bridget.
Let's start off talking about the Fukushima tragedy. What kind of impact has that had on the nuclear industry?
It turned last year into a very challenging year for both nuclear and uranium industries, and particularly from a focus, and rightfully so, of safety and backup procedures that existing reactors throughout the world examined and reviewed and really made sure that it put that right focus out there for the industry.
So would you say there were lessons learned from that then?
Absolutely. And the nuclear industry, going back to the events at Three Mile Island and at Chernobyl, has always been extremely responsive in issues that it might face, understand and learn from it, and put the wheels in motion. And I think over the years to come, there'll still be perhaps lessons learned from Fukushima. These things are complicated and take a long time to really understand and implement.
Well, let's drill down a little bit. You are the CEO of a uranium company. So what about the impact on uranium companies, talking about access to capital? Has that dried up a little since Fukushima?
Well, first of all, it has. And it has also affected negatively, let's say, the market sentiment towards uranium and nuclear. And it really wiped a lot of market capitalization from publicly listed uranium companies. Many of us, including my company, are trading at 50% of our pre-Fukushima highs. But the reality is that the key drivers of nuclear power and growth in nuclear industry are the same. Governments are looking for security of supply when it comes to power generation and clean and reliable sources of energy. And the reality is nuclear still has those qualities about it. It is clean, it is emission-free, it is large-scale, and it is low-cost. And so because of that, there still is a very strong growth profile to worldwide nuclear capacity over the next 20 years, especially coming from places like China, India, basically the emerging economies, where 20% of the world's population is still without electricity.
Yet there still seems to be a lot of hesitancy. And, you know, Germany, I think, taking that stand right after Fukushima and saying that they were going to close down any of their nuclear facilities. So how do you then, as a CEO of a uranium company in that space, how do you position yourself since Fukushima?
Well, I think there's twofold. Number one, I think we got to look at the whole picture. And when we look at the whole picture worldwide, we see that, let's say, Germany and Switzerland that talked about phasing out their nuclear reactors over the next 20 years, and 20 years from now represent maybe 3% of global nuclear capacity. The reality is the economies that are expanding most rapidly are the ones that need nuclear and new energy sources the most. For me, as a CEO of a uranium company and with Uranium Energy Corp, we believe that this is an incredible opportunity to grow our business, because many smaller companies are in fact having a very tough time, as we touched on, raising money. This is a great time for us as the newest uranium producer in North America, with having a little bit more financial strength than, let's say, an explorer or a development stage company, to buy projects at attractive valuations. Just this morning we announced our fourth acquisition post Fukushima. In fact, I think we're the only uranium company that has made four acquisitions post-Fukushima. So we're putting our money where our mouth is. We do believe in the long-term prospects, and this is a good time to grow.
You operate primarily in Texas, so let's talk about production. We'll first concentrate on the U.S. Any states that have more exploration success than others?
Well, we focus entirely on states, and especially Texas, where we thought there was a good understanding of uranium mining so you can permit projects. In the last 6 years, two of the newest uranium projects in the U.S. have started production in South Texas, where there's a fairly active uranium belt down there. We started production exactly about a year ago. We're the newest uranium producer in North America, first one in the U.S. in 5 years. There's a good business-friendly, mining-friendly, energy-friendly attitude in Texas, and that's what you need with uranium to be able to permit projects.
Would you say that same dynamic exists north of the border here in Canada?
It's really province by province. I mean, in the past, in a province, I mean, hey, let's not go far. Right here in BC, where we're doing this interview in Vancouver, our government has a moratorium on uranium mining. But you know, a couple of provinces over in Saskatchewan, it's one of the biggest producing areas, the Athabasca Basin, for uranium. So it's the same in the U.S. The state of Virginia has a ban on uranium mining. Texas allows it. Arizona's okay. But California, maybe don't talk about it. So I think it's really state by state or province by province.
Definitely. What is your overall outlook for 2012 then?
I really believe that the fact that we still have today a supply shortage of uranium just for reactor requirements right now, not for new reactors to be built. There's a shortage of uranium in the world. We've relied heavily on secondary supplies for the past 20 years. I really believe 2012 is going to be, let's say, the comeback year for uranium off of the real challenging year that 2011 was. If I sat here a year ago before Fukushima and gave you the three reasons why I was bullish on uranium, those three reasons being the emerging economy's expansion of nuclear capacity, shortage of uranium in the world, and the disappearance of secondary supplies by next year, 2013 is the end of a major secondary supply contract, those would be the three reasons I'd be bullish uranium. Those are the exact same three reasons one should be bullish on uranium and higher uranium prices today. Fukushima hasn't changed that. Fukushima was a very tough event for Japanese people, but we should also remember that was an earthquake and tsunami, unprecedented, and it killed thousands of people, the earthquake and tsunami, not nuclear power.
All right, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks for having me.